NHL Tonight, presented by Mass Mutual with Jody Shelley and Sue Grimson. I'm Jamie Hirsch. Okay, so through eight game ones, the road team has won six of them. Yes, 6-2 is the record of the road teams so far through the first game of all of these different series. So buckle up. We've got four more game twos on this Wednesday evening, and it took overtime to decide the Islanders and Hurricanes. So with that, let's get right to the action from Raleigh. Down in Carolina, Canes coming off a big win on Monday. One of the few home teams to actually win their game one. Looking to take that 2-0 series lead, and the Caniacs are letting them hear it. 6 minutes in, the Canes with the puck. Seth Jarvis is going to set up a one-timer for Jacob Slavin here. And it's tipped at the net by Paul Stastny, and he scores. Hurricanes strike first.
Brett Burns gets it all started. Really aggressive and up in the attack, pushing it. Ultimately, it goes from low to high, spits out to Slavin on the far side, and boy, does Slavin pound that home. Big strike gets you going, 1-0 Kane style.
Nearing the midway point, or past the midway point, rather, Isles with it. Casey Cizikas is going to get called for a high stick on Sebastian Aho. The Islanders are going to try to kill off a four-minute minor.
Yeah, this line, they're not going to pass up a hit in there. That one just gets a little high, so 4 minutes, two power plays right away for the Hurricanes.
They did kill it off, but how about those chances by the Canes at even strength? Jordan Staal with a hit in the back that sparks a team-wide fight. 2 minutes for interference to start the next period for Matt Martin.
Yeah, really aggressive play by Matt Martin. Staal had just finished playing that puck, comes at him really strong from behind, and then how about the extra? Kind of knee drops him from behind while Staal is completely prone on the ice, and that's the way that New York will start the period the following second.
Hurricanes trying to pile on, and we've got another penalty here, another high stick, and another four-minute double minor.
Yeah, early in the second period, you can see just a play in front of the net. Pesci takes it up high, and Lane Lambert, yeah, he's furious. As again, a double minor. Hard to believe two that early in a game.
Late in the power play, how about this for bad puck luck if you're an Isles fan? Stefan Nason has a shot deflected by the Islanders' Sebastian Aho.
Nason gains the blue line, and he's just making a little pass out in front of Natchez. Aho gets a piece of that. He's trying to clear it out of harm's way, knocks it into the net.
The Islanders answer here a couple minutes later, though. Kyle Palmieri with a beauty off his backhand.
Yeah, he committed here. He wins that race and gets the inside position on Burns. And he's got Engvall in front of the net, and that breaks the ice for the Islanders. But here they come.
And it's Matt Barzal. Great shot to tie it. It's his first goal since February 9th.
Yeah, long layoff for Barzal. You needed this from him. This is your key offensive driver if you're the New York Islanders. And Barzal, smart shot, all kinds of speed through traffic.
What a shot by Brock Nelson. Beats his man and scores. The Islanders score three straight to take the lead.
Yeah, nice little transition here. Nelson crafty. He gets around the offensive player, and then he gets in there and puts that puck in. And big moment to tie that up.
Now the Hurricanes looking to tie it here. Slavin with a shot, scores off the head of Sorokin, and we're all tied up at three.
This will go down as my favorite of the night so far. Jacob Slavin way up in the attack. Stick under the goal line, off the head of Sorokin and in.
Hurricanes have it here late. Ryan Pulock called for tripping on Jarvis. Penalty.
Islanders did not have one power play, and Carolina had six.
Whew. Nice, strong saves by Sorokin down the stretch, still tied at three. Teuvo Teravainen with it, shoots that puck. Sorokin with a huge save, but Teravainen breaks his hand on the play, as we will hear about later from Rod Brindamore. We go to overtime, folks. 5 minutes in, Jordan Martineau high stick Scott Mayfield. No call on the play.
Oh, this is tough. I mean, this is overtime. You can see the linesman there. He kind of checks around, too, to see what's happening. And then just off that play, it's Carolina in transition. Martinuk uses that stick again, and you know it.
Jesper Foss with the OT winner.
Give him all kinds of credit. Foss recognizes Stahl's in a great spot. He's got clear control. Beautiful forehand dish diagonally through the offensive zone, and Foss from a really sharp angle, especially for a righty, beats Sorokin back the far side to break a 3-3 tie. There you go. Canes up 2-0 versus the Islanders.
Man, and what a game, a back-and-forth affair. You got to feel for the Islanders fans because it seemed like they gave it their best effort. Let's hear from Jesper Foss, your OT hero, on this comeback win.
Great effort, I feel. As soon as they got a lead, I feel like we start playing a little more the way we need to play. So, good response from us, and I mean, what a great experience this was. I mean, it's always we want to stay on the winning side here at home, and now we got to just keep playing the same way and get the next win.
Lane, how did you see the game-winning goal develop?
Just a quick transition play, and they executed on a lateral pass.
Did you get any explanation from the league or the refs as to the incident with Mayfield right before the?
No.
Is that bothersome that they potentially missed a call right before the goal?
Yeah.
And do you have any update on Tavo?
Yeah,
I guess
he's out. Last 425 marker, he broke his hand with the puck, takes a shot. The guy absolutely tomahawk chops him. Absolutely. And I know we had all the power plays, so you're not going to make it a 5-on-3. Go take a look at the video. And he's out for the series. So there you go. And they're going to complain about all the power plays, but the tomahawk chop, we just watched it. He has to have surgery tomorrow. There you go. So I'm a little pissed, I'll be honest with you.
Roddy B all fired up, and why not? Because he thought it should have been a call, and also, as he said, Teravainen now out for the rest of the series, and probably longer if he's going to have surgery on a broken hand. You see the disparity with the Islanders kept without a power play, and Carolina 6 opportunities and just 1 power play goal. But what's your reaction to the news that Teravainen is now going to be out for the rest of the series and then some?
Yeah, you can understand Rod's reaction. I mean, that's a key offensive driver. That's a key component for you. You hate to be without a guy like that. I mean, a broken bone is 6 weeks. A broken bone that requires surgery probably goes beyond 6 weeks, in my amateur medical opinion. So obviously that's a tough go. But hey, listen, that's the Stanley Cup playoffs. There are moments like that. Injuries are going to happen from time to time. You know, for Rod and his Canes, you came out on the right side of this one. You got a lot to be thankful for. But really, where that hits you specifically is everybody kind of now needs to push up on the left side of the forward compartment for these Carolina Hurricanes, and you're kind of slotting people out of order to some degree. So you got folks who you're going to be getting more responsibility, who have to perform and execute with more responsibility.
Yeah, Svechnikov out, now Teravainen is another top 6 player, and you saw there Pageau, he's chopping at the stick just to time it off the shot, and looking at it, doesn't look like much of a play, but caught him on the right spot, and unfortunately, he's gone. So tough news for the Carolina Hurricanes. Mm-hmm. Kind of overshadows the win a little bit, according to Ron Brindamore, but they're going to have to do the next man up here.
Yes, they certainly will, and we haven't even mentioned the fact that, again, they thought they'd have Max Pacioretty at this time of year, and they don't have him either, so certainly not the lineup that Rod Brindamore thought he would have going down the stretch in this series, but the good news here is they have the 2-0 series lead, and it was a hard-fought win. Let's go to that overtime goal. Break it down for us. What happened here?
You know, it's a really interesting play. Turnover takes place in the offensive zone. There's a bit of a skirmish on the wall between Martinuk and Mayfield get tangled up. Mayfield kind of gets caught up out of play. It transitions right back. Burns gets it going the other way. And I'll tell you what, the play from Stahl after Burns makes that transitional pass, the play from Stahl to get it over to Foss, it's really kind of a two-part play. The pass itself from Stahl and then the finish from Jesper Foss, that's high execution. Thought Sorokin was capable of a better save just the way that one developed. Again, Foss is a right-handed shooter. He's at a really extreme angle. I thought Sorokin might have been in a place where he could kind of snuff that out, but that's a shot well placed, and,
You gave yourself a chance to come out on top with the way you played it when you're Carolina.
Beautiful goal. I mean, there was a high stick that was missed in that play, too, and Mayfield got stuck by Martinook. So yeah. Those things happen within the game. But that was, you know, you get in the overtime, and those things happen. It comes back the other way, and the goal goes against you. But you do have to credit Jordan Staal with that pass. It was a beautiful play.
Sweet
feed. You know, to beat Sorokin in overtime like that.
Yeah.
That was a heck of a shot.
Yeah, well done. And speaking of heck of a shot, how about Jacob Slavin below the goal line? I think we're going to watch this about 10 times because it was that pretty. And not just the goal, though. What impressed you the most about both him and Brent Burns on the blue line for Carolina?
When you have defensemen that are up in the play all the time, and I mean up in the play and being effective, it's hard to defend against. So you see the puck on the right side of the ice here, and Slavin is up. He's the defenseman that's down in the corner now. There goes the line change Stu was just talking about. Now, he's holding the puck there. Time. How about Brent Burns? He's cheating. He knows there's two guys coming off the bench, so he says, forget it. You guys play D. I'm going to keep this alive. And as they keep this set up, nice little bounce there, and then Stastny puts that home. So when you have that on-your-toes mentality from the defenseman, and here goes that line change you were just mentioning. There he is on the puck. Slavin's aware. He's responsible. He knows that. He's got to do all he can to keep that puck in the corner. And Burns activates as well and also checks to make sure that, hey, I got numbers behind me. I'm going to take the risk and win this battle. And, boy, does it ever pay off. And those are the moments when you have mobile D. Burns started his career as a forward, and he's got that mentality still in his head. And then this is Slavin on the other side scoring a goal. And, again, this is off the faceoff. He's not retreating right away back to his position. And I love that trust about the Carolina Hurricanes. Yeah. You know, it's like, go. If you see it, you stay down there. The forward will have the responsibility to cover for you.
Yeah, right. You listen to his comments post-game. It's like, I was kind of in the right spot. I thought I'd take a shot there. Got a lucky bounce. I mean, when you play it from underneath the goal line and you're trying to go in off the exposed part, the goaltender's head, and you actually are able to bank that, I appreciate the humble gesture that it was a lucky shot. You executed, my friend. Well played. And I tell you what, that's a connected piece to the Teravainen loss as well, right? Because that's part of the identity of this Carolina team. They activate guys like Slavin, like Burns. They're very, very, they're up in the attack. Yeah. And you can kind of compensate that way. Like, you've got to be judicious. But, yeah, you're missing a guy in Teravainen who's capable of 60 points plus a year. He's a factor for you in the postseason. But you can activate from the blue line. So perhaps you're going to see they're able to compensate to some degree from the back end where Teravainen, the loss of Teravainen. Concerned.
Well, it certainly paid dividends in this game. It's a 4-3 overtime win for the Carolina Hurricanes to go to Long Island up 2-0. When we come back, it was not the same story in Boston. The Bruins, who had just 4 regulation losses on home ice all year, fell in a big way to the Cats. Stay tuned.
NHL Tonight, presented by Mass Mutual. Planning and protection for those who matter most. On and off the ice.
Welcome back to NHL Tonight, presented by Mass Mutual. Last year's President's Trophy winners against this year's President's Trophy winners. Patrice Bergeron missed game one, still out for tonight's matchup with an upper body injury, but Sam Bennett back for the Panthers for the first time since March 20th. 4 minutes into the first, Tyler Bertuzzi, who was all over game one, turns it over here, and that's trouble. Great save by Linus Ullmark on Lucarini's front.
Uncharacteristic turnover for the Bees. You don't amass the best record in professional hockey ever making puck decisions like that.
David Pastrnak trying to get possession, but he gets tripped up by Gustav Forsling, and the Bees will go to the power play.
Yeah, and then he gets a little extra here as he's down. You can see he's holding his mouth. Paul Maurice not happy, though.
I don't know if you got much to beef about there,
right? Though.
That's a pretty good call.
Standard.
Puck loose here. Alexander Barkov with a shorthanded chance, and Ullmark gets the pat on it.
He is a beast. I'll tell you, 95% of the players in the game, given where Krejci is, don't get that chance. Big, heavy, just not able to tuck it up and over the pad of Ullmark.
Scoreless after one, about a minute and a half into the second. Brandon Carlo turns it over. It's Tkachuk to Bennett. He scores. Welcome back, Sammy B.
Good job by Tkachuk. He backs off the play.
Good pressure on the wall by Nosek. Does a great job to kind of smother Duclair. Duclair makes a play he doesn't want to make. turns it over. Marchand buries it to even the score.
5 minutes to go. The Panthers in the zone. Nick Cousins finds Eric Staal, and he scores with the Cats back on top.
Yeah, Bertuzzi and Pastrnak collided. A lot of time and space for Staal, and he used it there. Great shot.
Seconds later, Ryan Lomberg gets called for slashing again.
Way out. That shouldn't beat you in 100 attempts, without question. But even take that one out of it, set that aside, his performance game one to game two, I thought he was a lot sharper. He's out at the top of the paint, and I really liked this body of work in game one. But game two, I thought he really dialed it up. He looks like one of the better tenders in the tournament to this point after his game two performance. Looked really composed to stop, steers it towards the deep corner so he's not creating extra opportunity in front of the net for him. He saw some grade A opportunity. That save in particular, notice how he's really looked composed in game one. But game two, I thought he really dialed it up. He looks like one of the better tenders in the tournament to this point after his game two performance. Looked really composed. He saw some grade A opportunity. That save in particular, notice how he's kind of steering that. He makes
that would go to Bobrovsky.
Yeah.
But obviously he has some element that if there's something else he brings in the locker room. He's the unsung hero, as Tkachuk put it. Mm. You know, and those are great things in playoffs when you're in a microcosm, kind of a small series or small moments within series that you can look at him and pull for him. And tonight, I thought they protected him well, too. Not a lot of rebound chances, and did a good job of that.
The moment is not lost on his teammates, and you heard Tkachuk say this. You know, we put him into some really tough spots this year, and he has responded. Like, I can't tell you how much that endears you to your teammates. Yeah. And that's kind of the subtext. It's the background on, you know, how he's playing, why he's playing, and again, that trust he has with the rest of the skaters on the team. But this is going to be a fun story to watch. He was, for me, the key storyline coming out of game two for Florida.
Yeah, well, Jody, you mentioned too that we got to give credit to the guys in front of him, right? Yeah. I mean, they did a really good job of limiting chances by Boston and really not even allowing them to get a lot of clean exits from their zone. How'd the Cats do it?
You know what? They started in game one with their approach. They were going to play on their toes defensively, and that meant pressing up in the offensive zone. So the Boston Bruins want to get out of their zone as quick as they can, but if you get the puck as a winger and the defenseman's already on top of you, you got nowhere to go. And sometimes you have to make adjustments within series or within games, and I thought the Bruins then tried to use the middle of the ice. And, you know, some of these were just careless turnovers or maybe turnovers where you think the player's there and he's not, high-risk plays. But this one's a play going up the wall that gets shut down and stuffed right back their throat. This one is one that tries to go up through the middle of the ice. Tkachuk is right there, and Bennett gets that first goal. And here, a great example of it. As McAvoy's trying to get that puck, it's on arrival.
Yeah.
You know, he's getting the puck. He's thinking he's going to make a play, and then that door is closed. And, of course, the other Florida Panther jerseys are right on top of it in support.
Yeah.
And so they're confident in playing within their system now because I think they saw some results, some not results, but bright moments in game one where they thought they could – kind of go after that, and they dial it up again in game two.
Jamie, you don't build the best record in pro hockey because you don't manage the puck well, and I thought the thing that Florida did exceptionally well, it's to the point that Jody's making, is the pressure was there. Just about every time that Boston had possession, there was a white jersey right in their face, and really it was, you know, the Verhaeghe goal, I think the first Verhaeghe goal on the night, you know, he creates that offensive pressure that forces, you know, a Marchand turnover, a play that Marchand wouldn't typically make,
right.
Ends up in the back of the net. So fun part of it to watch. You hear Coach Montgomery talking about it coming out of game two. There's some things that they're going to need to address.
Yeah.
Puck management, puck decisions, how to contend with that F1, F2 mm-hmm. pressure that you're getting from Florida. That'll be chief among the list of things to clean up going into game three.
And let's be real, Boston really misses Patrice Bergeron. Again, he missed both of the first two games of the series so far. Yeah. They're considering him day-to-day. They hope to have him back in game three, but one guy that did come back, Sam Bennett, he certainly had an impact in this one, huh?
Boy, did he ever. And remember, this is, you know, this is a guy that comes with playoff DNA. His first playoff season as a member of the Florida Panthers coming over, he was like a house ablaze. It was a complete rejuvenation, but he really looked very comfortable back in the mix in the early going. Throwing the body around, you know, he plays an abrasive style of hockey. On the night, he's got a goal. He's got 7 shots. Ends up a +2, 3 hits, 9 total attempts. Like, that's a really busy night for a guy that, you know, has been out of the mix for a good long while. This is an important strike. It gets Florida going early. You know, it's easy to overstate the importance of a first goal, but I think it really was critical to a Florida victory here tonight. It got Boston out of their rhythm. It got Boston on their heels. And I think as much as anything, I thought Florida's game from that moment on kind of grew. The turnover started to come from that you pointed to, Jody. Bennett was a key contributor tonight, really a factor.
Second line center, you know, he plays with Tkachuk. He's got some bite. You know, he likes to be the first one on the forecheck. He doesn't turn away from finishing checks, so he's a presence almost every shift. And when you're playing against the Boston Bruins and you're bringing a factor like that, and you think about the locker room, this is a guy that they miss in the locker room, an important piece of Bennett. And for him to go out and get the first goal, and that's the type of guy he is. You mentioned when he got to Florida, he was a great playoff performer. But I think his first shift, he went out and had two hits. So, you know, that's the kind of energy you're waiting for sometimes within games. So he brought that element, a guy that you could tell the Florida Panthers like to follow.
Yeah, an impressive response game for the Florida Panthers. And they send this back to South Florida, all tied up at one. Coming up, Leon Draisaitl and the Oilers jumped out to a two-goal lead. But stop me if you've heard this before. Here come the Kings, a back-and-forth affair in Edmonton, and that's next on NHL Tonight. Welcome back to NHL Tonight, presented by Mass Mutual. Game two between the Oilers and Kings from Edmonton. Connor McDavid and the Oilers looking for some revenge after dropping game one. No Matthias Janmark for Edmonton. And the Kings hoping to stay zen and go up 2-0. Yes, there you go. Let's get to the action, shall we? 2.5 minutes in, the Kings bringing it up the ice with speed. Klim Kostin lays a big hit on Arthur Kaliev, and Leon Draisaitl picks it up, weaves in, makes a nifty little move, and fires wide. But Derek Ryan scores 5-hole on the rebound.
What a way to start. I'll tell you what, you get that big rig going. Leon Draisaitl is a force. Quick transition by this Edmonton Oilers team, and then that shot from the outside. Leon's got designs for the net. It ricochets off the back wall off a deflection. Ryan taps it home.
The Kings win the draw here. Draisaitl slashes Adrian Kempe and is sent to the box. So the Kings go on the power play. 30 seconds to go in the man advantage. McDavid takes off with it, and that's going to be trouble. 2-on-1 over to Evander Kane. His shot saved by Jonas Korpisalo.
Wow, the speed of McDavid here. He's got Kane on his right. See how he's just checking him out. Not perfect off the skate to Kane, but he tries to make something of it. Nice
now,
job.
Kostin leading a break. His shot goes off the bar. Puck comes to Evan Bouchard, who's tripped up by Alex Iafallo, and that tripping call will put the Oilers back on the power play. So, ensuing power play here. Bouchard feeds McDavid. A perfect pass. Cross ice to Draisaitl, who makes no mistake on the one-timer.
I'll tell you what. Leave it to Connor McDavid. There's probably no passing seam there for 95% of the players in the game. Quick stride, opens one up, fires it through to Leon for the score.
2.5 into the second. Warren Fogel dodges a check and throws a backhand in front. Saved by Korpisalo. Nick Bjugstad shoots. And Korpisalo makes a spectacular glove save. Wow. Now Kempe going back in front to Philip Deneau. First shot denied, but his second effort is going to go in 5-hole. First of the playoffs for Deneau.
Ooh, gets quiet there in Edmonton. They're up to that 2-goal lead again. Familiar territory, and Skinner just can't squeeze that.
Final minute of the second, a turnover in the neutral zone. Gabe Vilardi, first game back, sneaks this one inside the post, and we are tied.
A pair of goals that Skinner allows, it just kind of leaves you, is there a better save selection there? It just looks a little passive, doesn't shore up the near side post, and I'll tell you what, your Kings are back in the mix.
15 seconds into the final frame, Oilers take it in at center ice, in comes McDavid. He is denied by Korpisalo. Kane can't connect. And now Kostin will take this in from center ice. Fires a wrister far side for the goal. The Oilers regain the lead.
There you go. Costin, big hit early in this game. He's an impact player, plays the game in a big way. And here he just gets a little bit of a shooting lane. Doesn't look like much outside the dots. You can see Durzi tries to contest it, doesn't get enough of it. And, oh, yeah, Edmonton's going crazy.
McDavid brings it behind the net. Wraparound try denied by Korpisalo. Kane tries to jam it in multiple times, and the Kings are going to take exception.
A little aggressive there.
Yeah, a little desperation late in the game. You appreciate where that comes from Kane.
And Kane going to get rewarded here. Exactly. The empty net. His first of the playoffs, and the Oilers and that guy, very happy.
Love me a good pair of blue sideburns. The bluer the better on the sideburns.
A mosh pit.
See it all in Edmonton, especially if these Oilers keep winning. Let's hear from Connor McDavid after the Oilers even the series.
You know, I think we've liked most of our game, just little stretches here and there where they seem to be capitalizing and really gaining momentum. So, you know, feel good about the win and head out on the road to find a way to get a few more.
It's the game of the momentum swings, and when we had it in the first, they're trying to come back. They come back. We had a good period. They had a good period. We got to just 0-0 going in the third, and the mentality would just go out and take it. Like, we can't sit back here. We got to go out trying to attack, and it was a really good individual performance by Klim that got us that go-ahead goal and then was able to lock it down in a really good manner.
So everyone up in Edmonton can take a huge sigh of relief. Jody, your parents up there.
Yes.
Yeah. Be very happy tomorrow morning.
They will be.
And, you know, even though Connor McDavid only had the one assist, you know, he was held scoreless entirely in the first game. It was really his buddy Leon Draisaitl that stole the show, that took command of this game with a goal and two helpers.
Yeah, it really did. You know, you can only pay so much attention to one aspect of this two-headed beast in Connor McDavid. And to some degree, maybe you helped to neutralize a Connor McDavid, but you've got a guy that is, you know, nearly equally as talented, who has also driven up his game this time of year. Leon Draisaitl is really putting together an impressive series here. Now to game two. A couple of big scoring plays here tonight.
Number two in that tandem is Leon Draisaitl. That's right. A dangerous tandem. And all we talked about is Connor McDavid. He took the league by storm. The numbers he put up, what he did in the regular season, so of course you have to plan against him. But, hey, Leon Draisaitl is one of those weapons that, you know, he's dangerous all the time. Mm-hmm. And when you give him a little more space and Connor gets all the focus, well, you see what happens.
Yeah.
And fortunately for the Oilers, it doesn't just have to be about McDavid and Draisaitl, because they suddenly are getting some secondary scoring, right? What'd you make of Klim Kostin playing the hero with the game winner?
Yeah, you love that. I mean, one aspect of this, your favorite time of year, you've got a new hero often stepping up just about every game. And in this one, it's somebody like a Klim Kostin, plays deeper in this roster, plays hard minutes. But I'll tell you what, a smart shot to take from the outside. You know, you mentioned that's just a wrister, but that's a wrister with a whole lot of heat on it. You don't see a lot of guys scoring from the outside, but does a great job. Recognizes his game, plays within himself, sees an opportunity to get a shot on net, albeit from, you know, a pretty distant vantage point, but it comes through traffic, and I think that's what ultimately ends up giving Korpisalo some problem.
Well, and the Edmonton Oilers, you talk about Connor McDavid, Leon Draisaitl, and it's everyone else. And they've won games down the stretch in the regular season without those guys contributing, and that kind of reflected what they did tonight. And it's an important piece of this team. A little relief from Connor here. He hasn't really lit things up yet. There's more to come from him. But when you get the depth in the scoring, the other guys chipping in to win game two, it's a big moment for this organization.
It is still a split. What do you guys expect? Game three in L.A.
Yeah, I expect a tight one. I mean, I think both these teams have a good gauge of, you know, what kind of game they need to put on the ice to be successful against the other. You know, you heard Coach McClellan from the Kings side talking about their starts. I expect to see a solid, cleaner 60 minutes from both clubs.
I would agree.
All right. Should be a good one on Friday night from L.A. When we come back, a lopsided affair in Dallas. Marc-Andre Fleury, your starter for Game 2. We'll discuss that and much more next on NHL Tonight.
NHL Tonight, presented by Mass Mutual. Planning and protection for those who matter most, on and off the ice.
Welcome back. How about the Wild and Stars? Minnesota looking to go up 2-0. Marc-Andre Fleury getting the game 2 nod, while game one hero Ryan Hartman is out with an upper body injury. Stars shorthanded early on, but the Wild turn it over, and Roope Hintz is in on a breakaway. Look at that. He scores. The first shot Marc-Andre Fleury faces beats him.
Jody, I'm not sure if I can think of a better way to start a game. Start a penalty kill. Then to snuff out Kaprizov on the far wall, turns over to Hintz, and I'll tell you what, you're not catching Roope Hintz with that kind of a lead. Beautiful finish. Tough circumstance for Marc-Andre Fleury, brand new to this series.
Oh, that is a double minor high stick for Jacob Middleton, who will sit for 4 stars to a power play. Now under 45 seconds to go on the double minor. Jason Robertson winds up. It's tipped in by Tyler Seguin, and Stars take an early 2-0 lead.
Lots of room at the top to work that puck around for the Dallas Stars, and then Seguin in front. He just waiting there, uncontested, and a beautiful tip right between the wickets of Marc-Andre Fleury.
And if you're worried about who's going to step up for Pavelski, there's your answer.
Gustav Nyquist throws one on net. It's deflected off Oscar Sundquist, who draws into the lineup for Minnesota.
Nyquist, great pickup, smart player, and right there he makes sure he gets it in that dangerous area. And there's Sundquist. What a look at that goal.
The Wild back within one as we go to the second period. Just around 4 minutes in, John Merrill with a cross check on Jamie Benn. So the Wild have to go back to the penalty kill. And 19 seconds into the man advantage, it's Hintz dropping for Ben, and he scores. Another power play goal for Dallas makes it 3-1.
Big play for the captain, Jamie Benn. His first of the series, a shot from the outside, catches Marc-Andre Fleury kind of flat-footed. You can see kind of threads it right through the wickets there. Another good play by Hintz.
2-on-1 for Dallas. Evgeny Dodonov scores off the rebound. The Stars score their first 5-on-5 goal to make it 4-1.
Yeah, they just came right out of the gate here. Undisciplined play by the Minnesota Wild. They're chasing the game a bit, and look at the confidence of the Dallas Stars. Stopping at the back post. Dodonov knows how to score goals, and right there he's got Fleury way out of position. Just got to scoop it past him.
Minnesota on a power play now. Puck goes down low. Marcus Johansson backhands it in to make it a 4-2 game.
Nice little tuck by Johansson. Catches that puck kind of in the leg. He's trying to get out of the way. Knocked it right down in front of him and able to tuck it in on the back.
Oh, look at the move by Freddie Hockey. Freddie Gaudreau, 11 seconds later, pulled well within one.
Yeah, he's got the speed there and quick hands to go to the backhand and beat Ottinger.
Miro Heiskanen now throws it down low. Dodonov with his second of the game.
Had to be 5 layers of traffic. Well played by Heiskanen. He finds the lane, gets it through.
Hintz in alone again, makes no mistake. Number 2 on the night for him.
The big man, when he gets moving, look out. He's got a wicked release with that shot, and there he goes low on Fleury.
Just like that, the Stars reclaim that 3-goal lead as we head to the third. Brandon Duhaime going to find this puck, and he's denied by Jake Ottinger.
Great play. Ottinger, big stop. He's seen a lot of action from the Minnesota Wild. They're able to get the better of him 3 times. He turns it back in this one.
Another power play, and it's Hintz for the hat trick. The hats come raining down at American Airlines Center, and it's a 7-3 lead.
Yeah, Roope Hintz having a night. Little nastiness at Kaprizov and Max Domi.
I don't know if that's a matchup that Kaprizov is looking at. I don't think that's a matchup Coach Dean Evason is looking for. Domi is a rather unassuming package, knows how to look after himself. Get out of that one. Just step out of that one, Kirill.
Comes to
more hockey for you to play later on.
Things got downright ugly in this game at times. 82 combined pims, 5 different 10-minute misconducts. You think these two might be division rivals? I'd say so. Let's get Jason Robertson's thoughts on a chippy game.
All right, Jason. Pretty loud in here, but let's give this a whirl. What were you able to execute on tonight as a team that allowed you to hang up 7 against this Minnesota Wild team?
Yeah, I think special teams played a huge part of it. We get the shorthanded goal early, and our power play was kind of feeling it too. So I think I kind of built on, and we were able to bury our chances tonight.
Speaking of built on, your head coach Pete DeBoer said that he felt you had another level to your game. You had a couple points tonight. Have you found that level? Do you feel settled into this contest?
Yeah, I think everyone's really getting a feel for it. Definitely it's a playoff atmosphere, so we're just getting our feet wet here. It was a great response tonight. We're going to try to build off it.
Okay, sadly, home sweet home here, and these great fans ago to the state of hockey. You just mentioned build on it. How do you do that on the road?
Yeah, so, you know, we've been a great road team this year. We got to stay disciplined. It's going to be a hostile environment. We know that. And we just got to have each other's back, stick to our game, and play hard.
We've enjoyed the first two. Thanks so much, Jason.
Yeah, thank you.
And it's an Enterprise hat trick for Rope Hintz. He actually also had a hat trick against Marc-Andre Fleury and the Wild back in December 4th, but this one stands bigger as a playoff hat trick, Jody.
Yeah, you know, Rupa Hintz, a great combination of speed and skill. He's got a wicked release with a shot. You can see a little more wide-open game here. This is later in the game, but he gets an opportunity, and they're on the power play, confident passing play of the Dallas Stars.
Stu, that first goal was the first shot that Fleury had faced, and again, he's basically in all alone. It's a shorthanded breakaway. What led to that great chance?
You know, it's a great piece of penalty killing. Dallas is doing they do a fabulous job of kind of tracking back towards the ice as Minnesota's trying to gain the offensive zone, Dallas's offensive zone. And they do a fabulous job of kind of jumping. Two penalty killers do a great job of jumping Kirill Kaprizov. Let's walk through it. You're going to see it develop right here. Here's Boldy. He comes back. Stop it right there, guys. I want to just highlight Rope Hintz. This is our guy right here. He's going to kind of track back through the middle of the ice, and he's just going to be in sound position. Positional shape as Boldy is going to sweep this puck wide, and Minnesota's attempting to kind of gain the offensive zone on the left side of the ice. So let it roll forward a little bit from there. Keep an eye on where Hintz is just kind of keeping himself in the middle of the ice. Stop it right here. Okay, this is the key play right here. Kaprizov has got the puck on the wall, but notice there's a pair of Dallas Stars that are going to jump Kaprizov right here. Both of these guys are converging on Kaprizov, and that will ultimately lead to the turnover. And note our guy Hintz, he's kind of taking stock of all this. He's keeping an eye on all that, and then he's going to jump at an opportune moment. Let it roll forward from there. Here's the turnover right there. Puck turns over. Stop right there. This is really a curious piece of it as well. Hintz right now has a great lane. He's got all kinds of open ice to deal with, and he recognizes on the other side of the ice, he's got a forward right here in Marcus Johansson. Johansson has taken a really peculiar route, and this is what makes the play possible for Hintz. If Johansson were a defender rather than a forward, he probably does a tight turn and takes back Hintz back through the middle of the ice and tries to discourage Hintz and keep him towards the outside. But because he's a forward, he makes this kind of wide turn trying to keep up his space. And then I think he ultimately wants to come back and attack Hintz from the inside. Can't get him. Hintz is off and running, and Hintz does a fabulous job. How about the top shelf, over the glove side, Marc-Andre Fleury? I'm telling you what, if you're Marc-Andre Fleury, you're new to the series, that's not the way you saw the you know, game two starting off for you. But a great job by the penalty kill for the Dallas Stars, and a beautiful finish. Great head of steam by Rope Hintz to get it started. Visions of great things to come. Boy, did he have a night. That might be the most impactful offensive performance we've seen in the playoffs to this point.
First hat trick we've seen in the playoffs to this point. And I want to go back to the decision to start Marc-Andre Fleury, because I think that surprised a lot of people, raised a lot of eyebrows. I know you have that goalie tandem that's worked for Minnesota all year long to get them to this point. But Jody, what did you make of the decision to sit Gustafson after he was your double overtime game winner in game one?
I was very surprised. I mean, Gustafson was the guy going head-to-head with Oettinger. They got the win in game one. He's the player that made some spectacular saves. And you can see Fleury's reaction on almost every goal here, the first three for sure. He's just not happy with where he's at. This one is tough. He's out of position, but there's a little bit of like, he's just not happy, not content with how he played the pucks in those situations. I know the Dallas Stars came out, and his first shot was against, of course, the star of the night, Rupe Hintz. But, you know, he's a veteran guy. He's been there before where he started a series on the bench. When you have Gustafson playing that well, when you find a number one who helps you win that game, I think you have to stick with it, and I think they overthought it.
I do, too. I thought Gustafson played well for this team down the stretch. He was an important part of why this group was able to stabilize at the goaltending position. So as you transition into the postseason, you declared him, this is our guy as we start off. And you know what? I think you've overanalyzed it at this point. There's no reason to turn away from starting Gustafsson in game two. He got you a win. He looked solid doing it. And yeah, okay, you went to double overtime, but this is a young athlete. And guess what? The guy on the other side went through that same double overtime. Roll the boys back out there. So you're in a bit of a quandary at this point. I mean, I do think you come back. I think forward decision going into next one. But I don't know. When you've got a winning recipe, don't tinker with it unless you've got a compelling reason. And again, the three of us don't know everything there is to know that goes into
that
decision. But based on what we do know, Gustafsson's my guy going into game two.
Yeah, and there's no question that Jake Oettinger is Dallas's guy going forward, and really always. He's meant everything to them all season long and now going into the playoffs. Let's hear from him after the win.
We got back in this series, and we played the game we wanted to play. We played a great game the other night, and lost a tight one. So to have the guys respond like that and put up seven goals, makes my life a lot easier. So it was a great game.
It's what we do, right? We've done it all year. The game, there's nothing was on Flower tonight. It was all on us.
When we come back, we tie a bow on night three around the Stanley Cup playoffs and also look ahead to Toronto, who will be without Michael Bunting for the next three games. Welcome back to NHL Tonight. The Department of Player Safety has handed down a suspension for Michael Bunting. Three playoff games for an illegal check to the head and interference against Tampa Bay's Eric Chernak, who, by the way, has been deemed out of game two tomorrow night in Toronto. Your reaction to the news?
Yeah, a little bit surprised. Three's a pretty stiff ride for the postseason. Postseason suspension kind of comes, we kind of say it's like a formula of two games in the regular season, might be one in the postseason. So had this occurred in the regular season, you might have seen five-ish or perhaps more. At the end of the day, I think it makes good sense to me. It's a nothing play. Bunting goes out of his way to make contact with Chernak. And here's the thing, and this came up in the explanation from the Department of Player Safety. Because he goes out of his way, the Department of Player Safety sees this as predatory. That's a key word, predatory. Again, it had nothing to do with the hockey play. He goes out of his way to make elbow, like chicken wing, contact with his head. And I think for that reason, that's why he gets jacked up for three. That's a stiff ride for this time of year.
Yeah, you know what? It was dangerous and unnecessary. And I thought that play on Chernak, he's injured. He's out of the lineup now. I just think those are the plays you're trying to make. So he's going to sit, and you can see his reaction. He didn't agree with it. But that changes a few things for the Toronto Maple Leafs and their depth chart. You can see Yarncroft's up there on the left.
Yeah, and they're already down one game to none with all the pressure in the world going back to Toronto tomorrow night.
I will say this, though. You hate to have Bunting subtracted out of there. Yarncroke has been a really great fill. 20-goal season, first time in his career. He's been a great fit for those Maple Leafs. So playing him higher, that's pretty good compensation, though you don't have Bunting in that spot.
And Yarncroke did score for the Toronto Maple Leafs in game one, so we'll see what he has as he's elevated in the lineup. We can't wait. The Stanley Cup playoffs roll on. Another fun night with a lot of game two action across the National. Keep it right here to NHL Network all playoffs long.